Can you guys hear me in the back, or all of you? Are you all in a food coma? Food coma. Okay. I'm sorry if I wake you up, but it's 22 in this time zone. So I better start. For some reason, when I was asked to speak here, I thought it was a good idea to have my talk before I start run stuff, and they kind of named the whole track run stuff. But that was not planned, that was by accident. I'm Kris Buytaert, for those who don't know me. I'm a Belgian dude. I'm one of the persons who, by accident, started a global movement for DevOps these days. About 7 years ago, we started a little small conference again with about 70 people. And these days we have DevOps days. We actually have 42 DevOps days all over the world. I just keynoted the one in Berlin yesterday. And it's a global movement. My background is that I used to be a software developer. And I used to be, that was like 97, 98, until the mid-2000s, where I was writing software in all kinds of languages. Perl, C, PHP, with some Java. So I was a guy writing code, I was a guy building those things. And I ended up eventually being a guy also deploying stuff. Writing machine, making clusters, building scalable platforms. In the early days, I've been doing that with open source software. I believe that's the only way you can actually build scalable platforms and build truly good software. About 10 years ago, I co-founded one of the bigger European open source consultancy shops, which is called Innovits. We have offices in two in Belgium, one in the Netherlands, one in Ukraine, and two in Czech Republic. And what we do is we help people deliver functionality with open source. A lot of people know me from the title of my blog, because each time they run a DNS problem, they curse, because everything is a DNS problem. I run a lot of conferences. Next to DevOps days, I also run Config Management Camp and a couple of others. But enough about me. Let's talk about this DevOps thing. What is this? Who can explain me what DevOps is? John can. If he's part of my fan club, he's following me around this week. He was in Ghent 2 weeks ago, DevOps days, and followed me to Config Management Camp. Just kidding. Are you going to Stockholm next week?
No.
So what's this DevOps thing? Basically, there's a lot of definitions about DevOps. But apart from the fact that it's a global movement, it's not a job title, it's not a team, one of the better definitions is what Damon Edwards and John Lewis came up with after they started interviewing a lot of people in their podcast called DevOps Cafe. They figured out that a lot of the organizations they were talking to were talking about what DevOps was for them, were talking about the culture of the organization, the fact that they automated everything in their infrastructure and applications, the fact that they were looking at monitoring and metrics with a different angle than what we were doing before. We were monitoring everything. But also the fact that they were sharing their experiences, they were sharing the software, they were not only sharing how their software was built, but also how they practiced these things. If you take CAMS, you get a scan. So we made an anagram out of it, and we put in the influence from the lean movement, which was pretty much added by Gene Kim. So clamps really is a good keyword to describe what DevOps is about. So let's start with culture. Where do we come from? What is fundamentally one of the bigger problems in delivering software? And it comes down to this. I call it the old days, because sadly today, not a lot has changed for a lot of organizations. But what it comes down to is that when you're in an operations team, every Friday afternoon, you're scared. because there might be somebody running into the office saying, hey, here's a piece of software, can you please put this in production? Because we have a national radio show going live at 5 and we want to show this to the world. And then all the ops guys go like, what's this written in? How do you deploy this? We don't have machines. What about security? How many users do you expect? Where's the users registering? Do we have databases? Do we need backups? And the guy with, well, with floppy, he's like, I don't know, we didn't think about that. And it's about 6 months too late before we even figure out what to do with it. And sadly, that is a reality we've been running into way too much. Who knows this? Who's experienced this? Who was the guy with floppy at 5 p.m.? See a couple of hands. And in a way, it is because organizations are broken. We throw stuff over the wall and we blame the other party. Patrick Bott, one of the other co-founders of DevOps Movement, is clearly illustrating that when they were on location at DevOps Day Cuba, that what happens if you throw a bottle of water over the wall? You get a waterfall. Who likes waterfall for software development? Who's awake? There's one guy awake. Who's alive? Who's a human being? So what's happening is that basically there's the wall of confusion between two groups of people. Well, the wall of confusion between a lot of groups of people, but the illustration is the people who write code, the people who manage the platforms, the people who operate the platforms. And it's painful. And we have to look at how this happens. It's fundamentally because of the different goals organizations have put to the people managing those teams. If you look at the development side of things, team lead, development team work, development management, they've been getting their money because of new releases, new features, new platforms, new functionality, and the speed at which they could deliver that. They were looking at functional stuff. On the other side of the room, or maybe even a different building, or even a completely different company, there were the operations guys. And they were being paid to keep stuff running. So as little as they could change, that was their ideal. They had to have no downtime, it had to be a scalable platform. And in a way, those goals were completely opposing. One team was doing one thing, and while they were doing that, were actually actively blocking the other team from achieving success. So, we don't want to do this anymore. There's new methodologies, there's new ideas on how to build software. We stopped doing waterfall. Some companies say, we're doing Agile now, what have we implemented this with Watermill? So you do upfront plannings, 4 months upfront, and you let the developers do sprints 2 weeks and standards. That's Scrum, right? The scaled Agile framework works really well. No, it doesn't work at all. It's bullshit. Or you have people who really do Scrum, or Kanban. Those organizations are adapting, but when you take a development team and you let those people deliver functionality at each commit or at each sprint, then the operations guys go like, hey, this is going too fast, because they're not prepared. And the operations guys, well, they might have a different modus of operandi. They might be working in a completely different way, because there's a power failure. There's a security issue somewhere. Yesterday, you're doing PHP development, there was a Drupal core security vulnerability at 7 p.m., which they all needed to fix, and everything needed to stop, because, well, we need to deploy all things again. They cannot plan upfront. They cannot promise that in the next 2 weeks they're going to deliver a bunch of functionality. So they need to do different work. So those guys might be doing Kanban rather than Scrum. So we're working in different spaces. We're working in different environments. And we also have different visions on how to deal with those new methodologies. Who's doing Scrum here? Do you have a definition of done? Do you like it? So in Scrum, there's this thing called the definition of done, which is basically giving you at the end of the sprint the idea that you've actually done your work. And for a lot of teams, that means we've written code, there's maybe design notes, maybe there's tests, there are something, but usually those do not take into account the operational part. It's a good tool to define transparency. It's a good tool to actually say, look, we've done stuff and we've made progress. But if you look at the English dictionary and say done, it basically means it's over. We don't need to do anything about it anymore. It's finished. And when those teams start growing in maturity, they start adding tests, they start figuring out, well, software is only valuable when it's in production. So done means it's in production. And then the operations guys say, well, put something in production, we don't know. What do you mean we don't know? No, we're not monitoring this. We have no clue how you deploy it. So they start adding, proving your definition of done to a point where they say, done, it's in production, and it's monitored. And it grows. The definition evolves based on the kind of product you're building, based on if you're actually delivering a service or if you're building a product that you ship. You have different reasons to say it's done. If you are doing a stack, which is online, which can do continuous delivery, you're looking at frequently releasing stuff, looking at updates, looking at upgrades, so the whole pack needs to be embedded. And if you're just shipping software and then running off to the next project, it's a completely different mindset. And in a way, for me, the definition of done for a software project where you deliver a service is pretty much this. A software project is not done until you have fully decommissioned it. Because each time it's running, you need to maintain it. You have platform fixes, you have performance tuning, and even at the end of the product, you need to be able to decommission it. You still need the backups, and you still need the data, or you need to upgrade it to a completely different platform and export that data and move it somewhere else. So that's a really different point of view on done than I've just finished this, my unit tests are green. It's a mindset that's changing. And it's a culture change. And DevOps is, in a way, the biggest part, a complete culture change in how you build and manage software. So what did the CAMS keyword stand for again? Culture. And automation. So let's go have a look at automation. What are we talking about? Automation. I want to be able to automate all the things. I mean, that's what computers are for, right? To make my life easy and be able to drink cocktails at a beach or play with my kids. And that's what the developers do when they go home at 5 in a lot of organizations. But then the work starts for the operations people because the non-functional requirements have not been taken into sprints. So there is a bunch of types of problems that we need to cover. There's software which is unbillable. It means at some point in time, somebody started writing code with a lot of dependencies, and by the time they ship it to the operations people, where they want to build it, and building can be compiling, but building can also mean that you build an artifact which you can ship where all the components that you need are found together in one archive. And what we often see is, well, there's between the first time that somebody started working on something and took a local copy of a piece of software or a library, and they then want to ship that to the operations folks. Those libraries have disappeared from the internet. Who can build this infrastructure again when GitHub is down? If some JavaScript developer decides that, well, this library, I don't want to have that anymore online, how many of you were screwed? So, that's a problem. That's a problem as an organization. you don't want to have. You want to be able to build your software. Another thing of those topics is you don't really specify exactly which version you want to use. So I want to use library X, Y, Z, M. Well, I'm still working on it, so I'm not sure. Maybe it's X, maybe it's Y. I'm just gonna not specify the exact version. But when a guy next to you, or a girl next to you says, build this thing, you're gonna have different results. And when you do the same build on three different machines at three different time slots, you're gonna have something completely different, which might work by accident. And typically it's the fact that it works by accident that it works for 3 weeks, and the fourth week it starts failing. So yeah, people depend on external dependencies like Ruby, Gemstone.org, or GitHub, and well, we can't build the software. We cannot build the software. We cannot deploy it. Then there's the people who have learned that, well, we're gonna work together with the operations folks, and we're actually gonna help them build software packages. And when we talk about software packages, we mean operating system packages like Debian files or RPMs. And they start writing, this is a real example from a project I was working on a couple of weeks ago. It's a real example of a spec file. So it's a Ruby-based project, and they figured out, hey, I've swapped the slides. So this is a spec file. And they actually take all the software, all the dependencies, they define everything, they make the directories where everything works, and then they copy all their files into the directory. And then there's a small part in here which has well and post install scripts. So what you get from the developer is a very nice packaged version of the software. And I like packages because packages give me the fact that I can have the dependencies in there, so I don't need to figure out whether it's for Kona 5.5 or it's MariaDB or which database it's going to depend on. They've already specified that for me, so that's awesome. It also gives me the opportunity to figure out any file on the file system where it came from. It came from exactly that package. And I know that if I verify that file system, that all the files in my file system are going to be accounted for. I know that not somebody managed to log onto the machine manually and change the file. And those are things you care about from an operational point of view. So this looked like a really good thing until we actually saw the install script. Because what it did was it basically installed Bundler, it did Bundle install, and it downloaded the whole fucking internet. And put it in places we never could reproduce. And the next time we tried to update it, old version was there and new versions were there. And it broke in all kinds of ways. So it was a good attempt, but it was definitely not good enough. Now, Ruby is not the only one that has this problem. Python has the same problem. Node.js has the same problem. The problem is, every single language thinks they need to reinvent packaging. And they try to do so, and they fail graciously. Because they go over multiple iterations of building a tool that actually is capable of installing the software. And eventually they start with the operating system package. So there's a lot of work going on in the Linux distributions to help software developers, to give them a pipeline, to give them something. They don't need to do this anymore. So then there's the other part. We build it and we want to deploy it. Typically, not all the files are somewhere in version control. I mean, you guys are all version control based, right? Even the ugly stuff like ClearCase, I would happily ignore that part. But this is 2017, so I kind of feel we're all using Git here. Anybody still not using version control? Those are probably also still asleep. Okay. So So people forget the version files. People typically forget the version crucial files, like the whole CSS layout.
So when you first go to a page that's supposed to be an application, you get like all the small gibberish and no clue it should be there. Or they forget to define their dependency. They forget the actual libraries they need. So yeah, this is our source code, but everything else we don't care about. We don't version because we assume the internet will be there. Or it's a brand new team and they just figured out, well, we're going to do this in Go, and it gives the source files. I mean, I like a challenge and I like figuring out how software needs to be built, but if I got about 2 hours to deploy something, that's not the moment I want to start learning how the Go ecosystem works and how stuff is working. That's when I want to be able to sit down with the developer and say, hey, let's work together and do this together so we can figure out some dependencies, but typically that's not what's happening. Lucidis kind of said this 2007, almost 10 years ago, maybe 10 years ago in February. We have computers for a reason. If my computer cannot install your software is broken. And that's still true. Come down to the next part. Software we cannot configure. Software where you decided that you're going to connect to localhost, and localhost has a database listening on port 3306. No, 7, because it's your local database, and you, well, for some reason you put it on 7. And that config is inside the artifact you ship. That config is compiled into your software. It's fun. Software where, in order to be able to use it, you generate something, maybe on the web UI, where I need to cut and paste the administrative password. Software where the only place where I can actually configure the database connections or the queuing connections is in the UI. Software where, well, the only way to actually make it operational is to go to the UI and click on the third button from the left and disable 5 features in the second option, and then move on. Tom Lyman Selly said, as a system administrator, I can tell when vendors hate me. And a lot of vendors hate us, specifically the proprietary ones. I don't know why. There's already enough hatred against them, but still they do not expose APIs for us to configure stuff. So with this kind of software, we end up abusing test utilities like Selenium to actually automate the deployment of those. And it's fun if you want to install one thingy as an end user, but if you want to deploy tons of nodes with different environments for different customers, this is not going to work. This is undeployable software. And then there is the lost flavor, the unrunnable one. Yes, I've had .exe files on the Linux platform. They actually were a.out formats, and for some reason they run. And that's before .NET was a thing on Linux. But people have absolutely no clue what they're sometimes shipping. They're just, yeah, give software, it works. I'll come back to the Docker problem later, but it's a Docker file. We have no container infrastructure. Or you build it, then it connects hard. Or you build in host names correctly. Remember, everything's a freaking DNS problem. So I cannot do reverse lookup, it's going to fail. Or the best one is to ignore the operation so long that you build something on your shiny new Ubuntu box, and you know that the corporate standard is Red Hat Enterprise, and you know that everybody is still running EL6 in that customer. But you do ship a Debian package, and you do build for the latest and greatest Python version, which you know that's not going to be deployed. And we can solve this if we work together, and if we sit together up front and talk to each other. So if we've solved all this by working together, we get the new challenge. Software runs now, but we want to have it scalable, we want to have it high available, so there's a whole new set of problems popping up. The untrustable software. Software that writes its state in /temp. Software that writes its state in a local SQLite database. Software that, when you talk to the developers, it's completely stateless. But there is a file system hidden somewhere where they write the states to.
8 non-distributed file system, a non-object store, rather than storing in the database or even in a key-value store. They do this. Or, even better, they actually do store it in a key-value store, but forget to tell us. And the application doesn't write out errors when the key-value store doesn't exist. So why is there different views when I'm logging from one node to another? Oh, we forgot to tell you, you need a Redis setup there. So we spent a lot of year working with developers, figuring out how to build high available systems. And it's difficult, because there is no one size fits all. Making a database high available is not something that's gonna work out of the box if you don't really know what you're doing. A lot of applications don't use the database provided indexing features. So you get random index numbers. And then they want to go to the cloud, but they haven't still fixed this. So that's on scale a lot, because all of those things are still on a local file system. And that's the reason why cloud adoption is still not fully fledged. Recognizable topics? So there's another big one. The unsecured application. You have your passwords in clear text in a config file. You pass the passwords on the command line. Hey, if somebody logs on to the box and does a PS, there's your passwords. But you have no encryption. That's probably even a better one because I can put wrappers around it. Or you have encryption built in for some version of a library that you modified yourself and put in a distribution because you didn't understand entropy. Or a version built in with a specific dependency which only works for your application. And I have no way of upgrading it. But there's a hard bleed and I need to upgrade it. So I need to be able to rebuild the software. Or applications with no authentication. Everybody can go to the whole API and basically update all the things or delete all the things. Problems that are all trivial to solve if you know about them. Camps, go to the M. And the M basically says, well, we're going to be able to monitor this thing. Is this thing even on? Is it working? I cannot count the number of pieces of software that I got to deploy where I started and then nothing happens. How do I test this? How do you know if it works? Maybe if you put a little bit of test like application started, it works. There is no logs. That's the default. The other side of the world is it's completely verbose and all the relevant information is somewhere to be found in, I don't know, there's no different log levels, there's logs at about, I think I actually had that like 3 weeks ago on a Sunday, we figured out that one of the applications was logging into MongoDB at about 4 gigabytes an hour, and we were told upfront that, well, we only needed a small Mongo, one single instance, because there was going to be about 2 gigs of data maximum in the application, but we're sending the log files to Mongo at 4 gigs an hour. How long do you think that system survived? It survived through the weekend because the operations guy was constantly, we crumbled the deletion of all the logs. Because we knew we didn't care about it and we could talk to the developer one day to fix it. Because yes, the developer was not on call, only the ops guys were. So yeah, logging is important and you can break them and get a lot of information out of it. We can use logs to correlate what's happening in applications. We can use logs to follow the stream of applications. And we can use them to test things. But if we can't monitor an application because the way we figure out it is damaged because the end user calls, then we have a problem. If we cannot measure it, we have the same problem. If there is no metrics coming from your application, then we don't know if it's working. Do we have one user? Do we have two users? Do we have 10,000 users? Is the loads we have on the platform because it's crappy code or because it's really busy? You want to be able to see that. And if you're running a JVM, you can get a bunch of things out of there, but not every language, not every tool set provides you with that. If I'm working with you guys as an ops guy and you're writing software, I want to have health pages. I want to have pages where I can query what is the status of the application. Can I still do business logic. Does it work? These days, there's tools like CodeHell Metrics Library, which trivially allow you to send your metrics to graphite endpoint, to SASD, and we can all learn from that. We can see what's happening in the whole ecosystem, the whole platform. But a lot of software developers just say, like, nah, whatever, don't care. It's the weekend. I want to get drunk. The fact that you guys love this, I'm scared, is still reality. So we got a lot of topics we can solve by just talking to each other, by working together, because none of this is rocket science. I mean, I've been putting it a bit in a bad light, like, is this really all the crap that can happen? But trust me, it still happens. In organizations where you expect that software is being delivered in a safe and secure way, in banks, in air traffic control, these are the defaults. So when we talk about sharing, we talk about sharing software, sharing experiences, but we also talk about sharing responsibilities and sharing pain. We've moved to a lot of organizations where we're now putting the developers on call, even putting the product owners on call, because when they've been paged out of bed for the fourth time in a week, that feature to do monitoring on the memory usage, gonna be on the backlog of the next print. Because now they know why it needs to be there. And the DevOps movement has been helping developers for the past 7-8 years to deal with this problem so that we can work together and solve it. And then this new thing came along. Who's using Docker here?
Not in production.
But my next question was going to be, who's happy with it? So for some reason, this Docker thing became a really big hype. At about a year, 2 years' time, it was all over the place. And a lot of us were like, yeah, this is just containers. We've been doing containers for like 9-10 years. LXC, vServer, OpenVZ, some other sales. This is just a nice UI for people who don't want to use Vagrant because it's too slow and whatever. But we never kind of grasped why it changed, why it moved so fast. And it was all Docker, Docker, Docker. Everybody was talking about it. And it typically takes about 2 years before enterprises adopt new technology. So now we start running into Docker usage in the enterprise. And this is what a typical Docker container looks like in the enterprise. It's full RHEL 7 built, it has SSH running, it has Oracle running, there's a queuing system inside, the VM, well, they use the VM basically, there's WebSphere in there, and then there's backup pages and all the thing. And the typical lifetime of such a container is 3 to 6 months. And then they accidentally reboot it, and oops, all the data is gone. And the reason why people have been doing this is because the private cloud or the public cloud is in there, and they're still stuck with legacy ID departments where they want to have a VM for their service. And the response they get is, here's like 4 Word documents, can you please print them and sign them in 5 times and then send them in, and in 4 weeks you'll get a virtual machine. And that's not how we want to work. So they basically ask once a year a really big, fat virtual machine, and they run their containers inside. And the shadow IT is winning. And what do we have then? We've got this. Recognize the slides? It's Friday. It's 4:30. Can you please put this container live? I'm sadly not kidding. Last time this happened to me was last week of August. Scary part was after I gave the keynote at MailsGov. Here's a container, can you please put this live? But we have no container infrastructure. I guess I can spin up Docker on a box, but it's going to fail in a couple of days because there's going to be kernel issues. I know you don't want to use my keyword net stack, which I have on EC2, but that's ready, but it's not at the customer ready. So I don't know where to deploy this. You really want to put your data inside the container? Even if I have a box running in container,
what would be the use case to have three Elasticsearch containers on the same physical machine? And we don't know, just deploy three. Okay. And where is this container coming from? So you look at the Docker files and there's like, from Alpine, okay. From Ubuntu, from Debian. Who's going to rebuild this if we have another kernel issue? Who's going to rebuild this if we have another SSL issue? How do we even monitor this? It's exactly the same problem as years ago. Only now the technology has changed. So this is what it looked like 11 days into operations. Here's the Docker file. It doesn't build because we're behind a corporate proxy. Those are two containers. We need to do the old Hexelsar scan. It's a different technology, but we need to work together again. How do we build the containers? Can we reproduce them? Can we rebuild them? And fundamentally, in a lot of those cases, is do you even need a container? Or do you just want to be on the next hype? Is this resume-driven development? Because we've done it in Docker. We're using Mesos and Marathon and Kubernetes. We don't know why. I think those guys reinvented a really great orchestration technology from 10 years ago, but we want to use it. And we forget about how this needs to be managed and how this needs to be operated. I've been in situations where we had a fully automated pipeline, continuous delivery in place, where we could go from source to production, including tests, in 10 to 15 minutes. And then one manager pulled in an external company and says, oh, they've just built this thing and here's a container. What just happened? If there was just some communication in the beginning of the project, like, there is a Git repository. If you build stuff this way, it's going to flow to production automatically. No, here's a container. Because there was no communication between the people. Would there have been an architectural difference? Would there have been performance difference if they would have talked and built it on the existing stack? Because it was a LAMP application. And we could fully deploy and cluster and scale a LAMP application, just not in a container, because we had no ways of figuring out how they build it. So, let's come to this. It's NoOps, and that's the Twitter fail whale, remember? So the question we need to ask ourselves is, again, with software, can we rebuild it from scratch? Can we rebuild it when GitHub is down? Can we rebuild it when RubyGems is down? All these things. Who's going to take responsibility? Who's responsible for security in this job? Wake up, John. Who's responsible for security
Everybody
in this job? You were raising your hand. Everybody's responsible for security in this job. If you forget about security in your job, you're running or writing or doing something in IT, you're making the world a worse place for us. Remember all the wireless access points bringing down half of EC2 3 weeks ago? That's because somebody thought security was not part of his job. And the real question is, can your business survive if you put out security issues? Can your business survive if you cannot rebuild your software? So this whole thing is still about collaboration. It's about working together. It's about not looking at it as what I've been doing half of the talk, looking at the developers, the operations people. It's about building a cross-functional team where you work together on building value for your organization. I took Docker as an example because it's a really easy victim. But any tool which is going to come for the next couple of years, whether it's going to be Docker or Rocket or Habitat or any of the other tools, we're going to have to work together to deliver software to our end users. And I hate what Docker has done to our culture problem because it's just 5 years back, but if we don't pay attention, there's going to be other tools that are going to set us back 5 years. We can put in place all the logging frameworks, all the monitoring frameworks, all the automated deployment frameworks, and build the ultimate Jenkins, Puppets, Graphite, Logstash-based environment. But if we don't work together with our peers, if we don't work together with the people writing the software, we're going to fail. And that is what DevOps is about. Working together, changing
how you build software. Any questions? Yeah, oh, there's questions here. All right, anonymous coward number one asks, what monitoring tools would you recommend? How much time do we have? I've got another slide deck, which is called the state of open source monitoring. The short answer to that is today, the way we build in monitoring is automated. So we use infrastructure as code, tools like Puppet and Chef. When we deploy an application, we define, this is what the application looked like, and this is how I monitor it. So when I scale to 10 nodes, when I scale to 50 nodes, or I decommission nodes, monitoring is going to be intact. We use tools like the Kinga to do that. It's going to do alerting on that. We use tools like Graphite to collect our metrics. Then we use tools like Logstash, the Elk stack, to actually aggregate our logs and be able to correlate from those. And most of those tools have their own ways of working. A couple of those tools have already improvements depending on the environment you're in. But the thing we do is use open source tools and automate them all the way so that we don't need to manually configure anything anymore. And that's giving us back the power to do monitoring and fun. The problem with monitoring in the old days was somebody once built a monitoring platform and 3 weeks later was completely outdated and everything was red. And people said, yeah, we know, but we don't have time to fix because it's out of sync. And we find a new law of monitoring because we could completely automate it. Does that answer the question? If you want to go more in detail, or if another speaker drops out, I can actually do my open source state of monitoring tool. If somebody wants to, so they can just pop up. How do you motivate ops and devs to communicate? How do you motivate people to go to work? The problem is not motivating ops and devs. They want to communicate, usually. The problem is cutting out the middle management and the people who think they need to be involved. And let the developers and the operations people and the security people and the storage people and the network people work together. You put them in teams together. You don't put them in different silos. And you align management so that they know, hey, we're building something together. And that helps to get people to talk together. And then there's the other typical things, like we organize internal DevOps days in companies so they get to know each other. We put them on the same work floor. We put them in chat rooms together. We make sure that they have social events together because there's nothing better than the ops guy and the dev guy sitting next to each other with the same hangover because they've been out drinking. Because then they have some common ground to think about. So we talked about beer, sushi, pizza, and get to know each other and learn from each other. More questions? What about distributed teams? It's a very good question, because you cannot put a distributed team together
to have a beer.
Well, actually, you can.
But not that often.
So, as I mentioned in the introduction, I have a pretty distributed team. I've got people in four different countries. And what we do is, the main problem initially with new people is that we cannot put a face to somebody. And we cannot put a face to somebody, it's really difficult to know who he is, how you deal with it. So when new people in the remote offices join, what we always do is we bring them into the headquarters. We bring them to Belgium for a week, 2 weeks, sometimes that's combined with a conference, and we get to know them. So that's the first step. You know your colleagues. They're not some number or Tom number 25 who's working in office number 7. You actually know them. And when they know them, it's already easy, because you have other tricks, like put up pictures of those people in your office. Then we have both a combination of online chat, everything we do happens in our Jabber rooms, and we have Hangout, where we actually use Jitsi, it's an open source alternative, because there's a bunch of limitations that Hangouts have. You can maximum have 10 people in a room. We use Jitsi in our own self-hosted platform, and we can have everybody in the room. Everybody sees each other,
when we have a real discussion and have some video conferencing, stand-ups happen in video conferences, even if it's people in the same room. So everybody is always involved. And today, with the technology we have around, that's not really a problem anymore. Does that answer your question? More questions? No more questions. All right. Well, thanks a lot.